Welcome to Conversation, Lehman College's series of discussions with major theater and musical figures of our time. Our guest today, for the second of a two-part chat, is the great American mezzo-soprano Marilyn Horne. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
That shows how we met. You were playing Samira in John Coriano in my opera, The Ghost of Versailles, at the Met in 1991 at the Metropolitan Opera.
Very happy memories.
It was a lot of fun, wasn't it?
Well, you know, anytime anybody writes for you a 12-minute scene?
Yes.
That's a scene stealer? Are you kidding? A show stealer? I'll take it.
Now, I don't remember the sequence of events, but how did you find out that you were going to be singing an Egyptian diva and part of it in Arabic?
I think I didn't quite know what it was, but I was very happy that I was going to have a role created for me.
Right.
And John was at that time the composer in residence with the Chicago Symphony.
Yes.
I was at the Chicago Opera singing.
Oh, right.
And we got together and I went over to his apartment and he played through what he had written so far, sort of banging on the piano, and I was trying to get an idea of it. But again, I wasn't quite sure how it was going to turn out, but I was very excited that I was going to be a part of it.
I remember that you were an incredible trooper during that performance, because you were having arthroscopic knee surgery or something going on.
I was having real problems with my knees.
You could barely walk, and yeah. There you were. You basically had a dance, not walking. I don't know
how
you did.
Well, remember that they created that divan for me wheeled in on, which was great. So I only had to dance, you know, part of the role.
That was an incredible experience. And that was, believe it or not, inspired by by Rossini.
I remember John told me that, of the final scene, the big concertato in Italiana in Algeri.
We were inspired directly by that.
That's one of the great concertatos that he wrote.
Right, and one of the only things that John told me we absolutely must do is have an alla turca scene, a Turkish scene, in this opera, because we both love that kind of fun.
Yeah.
And they did those in the 18th century and the 19th century, and so this was our modern reflection on that. And I don't know if you're aware of it, but some of those lyrics were out of the Berlitz Arabic handbook.
I had enough trouble singing in Arabic.
I thought that we might hear a little bit of Isabella from Italian Girl in Algiers, Cruda Sorte. We can't do this show without hearing
it. Okay.
That. And
that is, by the way, going to come out on DVDs in the beginning of the year.
Beautiful.
The Met that's telecast.
That's the one we're going to play.
They're going to finally release it.
Brava.
Yeah.
Let's hear it.
Watch myself or listen to myself. The only time I ever do is when I have to approve something for release or re-release. So I'm fascinated and I'm sitting here critiquing the whole damn thing.
Well, do you like it? I can't help it.
It's okay. a couple of years ago, I had a re-release, but it was a compilation of many discs of mine was released called The Golden Voice, blah, blah, blah. And it's a two-CD compilation of many of my recordings. And I had to listen to them all in order to to choose what I would like to have on the album, et cetera, et cetera. And finally, when it was all over, I said to my daughter, I said, you know, I was a pretty damn good singer. So I think when you get perspective, you know, of 30 years or so, you're not nearly as critical. That's because if it had been something that I had just done, I would sit there and go, I don't like that, I don't like that. But a little bit later, you think, well, it wasn't so bad.
I'm glad you feel that way. I was wondering, why do you think Buffa delights us so?
Well, I think we like to laugh, for one thing. But the kind of Buffo that Rossini wrote was, well, first of all, he was a genius. You know, there's no question about that. And he wrote it with that unbelievable kind of Italian humor that it's just so special. And if you really delve into these operas and really get to know these characters in the comic operas, you really see, oh, you can see that on the street in Italian today. Italy, I mean. You can just see these characters, and he just defined them so unbelievably. I think, you know, besides, again, he was able to write it all with his genius.
I've had the feeling that, you know, the libretti of these operas are often belittled as unbelievable and silly and all that kind of stuff. But I have a feeling that a good part of the delight is the very silliness of some of the libretti.
Well, the libretti are wonderful.
I think so, too.
You know, my dear old friend Nicola Rossigno, who great Italian-American conductor, who's still alive, by the way, everybody, about 90 years old. I spoke to him in Rome not too long ago. He said the thing that I think is perfect. He said that the Barber of Seville is bottled sunshine. And that's exactly what it is.
I think it captures the... I was studying the Beaumarchais plays, because I used the last Beaumarchais play of the Figaro trilogy in Ghosts of Versailles. And I think the Barber of Seville of Rossini really captures the Beaumarchais play much more closely than the Mozart opera does of the marriage of Figaro. The Barber of Seville is much closer to the kind of sparkling quality that was in the original play. At least that's my opinion.
Well, that's a very interesting. I can't say that I've really studied the plays of Beaumarchais. I've certainly been involved with them.
Effervescence. And I think the very unlikeliness, perhaps, of those libretti catch our attention, and we're in a world of delight, and we need that more and more.
Oh, well, I think we always need it.
That's true. What do you think in you was so captivated by that clever Italian girl, Isabella?
It suited me well. The part just suited me. It suited my voice. It suited my temperament. I've always had a really, what can I say, interesting and funny bent to me. I've always been, you know, part comedian, and and I go into it, you know, with feeling like, oh yeah, this is home base.
When you learn a role, do you learn? I don't even know how to phrase this. Do you learn the music separately from the acting, or is this?
Put them all together immediately. Probably, on hindsight, if I had been smarter, I probably would have paid a lot more attention first to the libretto and really gotten into the words first. I know that now as a teacher, but I was so anxious to get into the music, I would start to learn that right along with it. And I mean, eventually, it was okay. But I think a singer probably has a leg up if they study the words first.
Right, prima le parole.
See, in questa.
Yeah. I have a libretto society that we call prima le parole. singing, you've said, is breath support.
Well, that's the ball game. You know, first of all, somebody has to give you a voice. You can't go to the store and buy it. It's not like a I hate to say this for all my wonderful instrumental friends, but it's not a violin that you can go purchase and say, well, I want to play this. You got to have it or you can't, or you don't. So that's a given. Then after that, you have to learn the technique of how to use it properly. Some people actually from nature learn how to use it properly. And obviously when I was a child, I was on that road that I knew instinctively how to breathe, how to produce the tones. That's genetic, right? It's something, and then of course they say that maybe that when the baby's born and the first sounds the baby hears are these sounds.
Right.
I certainly heard my father singing all the time. I heard my mother singing to me. In fact, my mother used to sit at the piano and play any song because she could play anything in the key of C. She couldn't read music, but she had that incredible gift
right.
of being able to play by ear, and she instinctively put the right harmonies in. That is a gift I would have loved to have inherited, but
right.
I did not. But her story is that at about age one, I was in my high chair, and she was playing the piano and singing to me, and I started to make noises like I wanted to sing. She says, I started going, and so she pulled me over closer, and within apparently very short order, I was singing, and that's when the famous Winter Wonderland
All
came
right.
in. That was my Glanzstück, as the Germans would say, my absolutely brilliant piece that I sang when I was a year and a half. But you know, my own daughter could sing many songs by the time she was a year and a half, and several languages, because we had a Danish nanny, so she sang some in Danish, and I would teach her some in you know, French and Italian and Spanish, and she could sing all of that at a year and a half, too. So
is she a singer now?
She occasionally sings. She has a fantastic voice. She's a shrink. She's a psychologist, uh-huh. and she's a mama. She very kindly gave me three incredible grandchildren.
Now, you were... is known not quite as much for your recitals, but in certain circles as much in for your recitals as for your opera work.
Well, a lot, yeah. It was a great love of mine, and I'm sure that was definitely fostered by my great teacher and mentor and accompanist, Gwendolyn Koldowski, and then Lotte Lehmann. I certainly studied
right.
all that German leader with Lehmann, and loved it, and loved what one can do in a recital. For instance, be a different character every song,
right.
and showing great diversity and versatility, and I liked that a lot.
Now, you love it so much that when you, quote, retired, I've never seen such a retirement in my life.
Quite at retirement yet.
No, you haven't. In 1994, you founded the Marilyn Horne Foundation, to support recitals.
Well, that, you know, it was the time I was facing my 60th birthday, and you know what mm-hmm. I say now, oh, to be 60 again.
Right.
And I felt it was time to give back. It's time to do something for somebody else. I've had so much from this great life in music, and I kept coming back to the fact that recitals are a very endangered species and still are, but it's a little better than it was. It's just that, like, you know, young singers especially who want to sing this repertory don't have the possibility to do it because the venues just aren't there. So I created this foundation to help shore that up, and here we are in 2006 and going strong, and I'm very happy to say we are probably one of the most respected recital producers in the whole country, perhaps the world, and very, really, really successful, and with a terrific reputation for quality and all of the good things. And it's a joy to hear the singers. At the Music Academy where I teach, we had very good fortune this year to have Latvi Mansuri, who's a wonderful stage director and
right.
was general director of the San Francisco Opera for many years, right, came and did a three-week sort of seminar, opera seminar, with my students. And the first day he asked them all to identify themselves, tell what they wanted to do with their lives and everything. That's the time when I always want to hear somebody say, I want to be rich and I want to be famous, but they never do. I want to have a great career and give back and all this. Anyway, I believe in all that too. But every one of them, to a person, 24 singers, said, I would love to have a marvelous career as a singer in opera, and I want to have a fabulous career as a recitalist. And under my breath, I'm saying, good luck. You better see me, you know, because this is just not going to happen unless we really dig in and keep doing this as much as we can.
When can we see the work of the...
The Marilyn Horne Foundation, yeah. The first recital of the season in New York. There are several, by the way, going on right mm-hmm. now throughout the country. Is on the 29th of October.
In the year 2006.
2006, and it's at the chapel at St. Bart's on Park Avenue and 50th.
Great.
And it's a wonderful young bass from California, and a terrific pianist from Georgia. Not, you know, Georgia, the one in
former Soviet Union.
Thank you. Whatever sea they're on, the Caspian Sea or the Aral Sea, one of those. And a beautiful pianist. And Evan Hughes and Tamara Sanikitze will be performing. And that's the first of our, what we call On Wings of Song series in New York.
Beautiful.
But we have a big festival at Carnegie Hall starting the 23rd of January, 23, 24, 25, and 26.
Of 2007.
2007, where we have master classes in Zankel Hall, of which they will be taught by Evelyn Lear, one of our great American sopranos, and Barbara Cook.
With whom you've been singing lately.
Yes, yeah, we see she's the latest lady that I've had this relationship with in duets. It's amazing.
Yes.
And then I'll be teaching one, and then we have what we call mini recitals in the afternoon of those same days in Weill Hall, where two young singers share a recital.
Can a general audience come?
Absolutely. Those tickets are available at Carnegie Hall. And then on the 26th, which is the last evening, we have a big gala, which is our only fundraiser of the year.
Right.
But there are decent prices for those in Zankel. And we'll be presenting four incredibly wonderful young singers in the concert, as well as our very special guest, Marcello Giordani.
Oh, very good.
Yeah, and we're very excited that he's going to be with us.
I wanted to, before we go any further, I wanted us to hear a bit of Canzonetta Spagnola by...
Should I repeat those dates?
Yes, repeat them.
January 23, 24, 25, and 26, 2007 at Carnegie Hall.
Do come.
Do come.
I thought it would be good to hear Canzonetta Spagnola by Rossini sung in Spanish.
Isn't this a wonderful piece? This was a
great
gift that the great Rossini scholar, Philip Gossett, gave to me.
Sung in 1994 by Marilyn Horne. The pianist is James Levine, and it's done in Carnegie Hall. Can we hear some of it?
Thank you. That was actually the first Marilyn Horne Foundation concert. They had all these incredible guests that night. Montserrat and Renee and Ruth Ann Swenson and Sam Raimi and Jimmy, of course, was there. And, I mean, it was an incredible, actually, it was afternoon, right on my birthday to the day.
Perfect.
And the temperature was 5 degrees, and the concert went about 3 hours. It was just so overloaded. And my brother very sweetly said to me, Jackie, well, longer than Schindler's List, but shorter than Gone with the Wind.
Canzonetta Spagnola, that was recently, relatively recently discovered?
Well, Phil Gossett, you know, he just knew where to get lots of songs when I was recording an album of Rossini songs for the first time, and it was about 1980, I think, and he presented me with that song. And boy, that was a great gift, because I not only sang it with piano, my dear and wonderful collaborator, accompanist Martin Katz, made an orchestral arrangement for me, which I sang many, many times with orchestra.
How much more Rossini is there, missing Rossini is there out there?
I don't know. I have a suspicion there's not too much that's still missing. I mean, the fact that Viaggio Reims came to light was incredible, because
it's staggering.
Yeah. But that was being hidden by somebody, you know, this woman.
She was hiding it?
Yeah, because she wanted to write a book on it or something like that. Phil Gossett could give you the details. And so she was sitting on it, and somehow somebody found out about it. I think she was in Rome or something, and got it out of her.
I wonder what else is out there. Well, it's something to think about. I
think there's still several Rossini operas that probably haven't been performed yet, but I could be wrong. The Pesaro Rossini Festival has really been resurrecting them.
Right. I wanted to ask you, because this is something that concerns me a great deal as a librettist, from your point of view, how do we return excitement to opera?
Are you talking about what's being written now?
And presented.
Presented now?
And written. What do you have any ideas on the subject?
You know, one really thinks about this a lot, and I have to say, the thing you really have to have is a great talent, a great composer who will come along, get a wonderfully great collaborator on the libretto, and just go. And that's what we need, you know. We need this kind of genius to be there, and we live in such a different time, though. You know, there were many, many more possibilities in the time of Rossini, right? Because the form of music at that time was so different. And remember that a song, I mean, an aria like Di Tanti Palpiti from Tancredi was the hit of the day. They talked about people walking down the street singing Di Tanti Palpiti. Well, that's not quite what we're singing today, right? You know, so it's a very hard thing now for opera to really be au courant and also be great, and then be for opera singers.
Right. What kind of opera would you like to see? What would thrill you? Do you know?
Something that's really captivating, something that's, you know, could be tremendously avant-garde, but have it be, as I said, great. And that's what I want to hear, something that just will take me and say, wow, you know.
Any particular kind of music, anything? You're open to anything?
I'm open to anything, absolutely anything. I think we've sort of passed through the serial music and 12-tone music genre, don't you think? Those are a little bit passé now. There was a time when the serial music was just ruling the roost, and nobody could sing anything.
Right.
Nobody could remember anything, even. It was so...
And audiences were sound asleep.
Yeah, right, exactly. You know, we still have to remember the word divertimento, because that's what opera is, part of that whole group. People talked and wrote about that they were diverted.
Right. It was an entertainment.
Exactly. It's entertainment.
Right.
Whether it's the kind you want to cry with or the kind you want to laugh with. It's entertainment.
Again, they're telling me we have to wrap it up.
I don't believe it.
It just whizzed by, didn't it? I'm sad to say we have to stop here, but that's what they're telling me. It's been a great pleasure to talk
with
you today.
Lots of fun. Thank you, Bill.
As we go out today, I wanted to play Stephen Foster's lovely song, Beautiful Dreamer, that you sang on a recording, The American Songbook, in 1986.
Well, this is one that my mother taught me from the piano.
Thank you, Marilyn Horne, and our home and studio audiences for joining us today. And we hope to see you again soon for further conversation.
Thank you.